Hey, so my name is Camel Claus, or as the taxman knows me as Claus Ibsen. So I work for Red Hat. I've been doing software engineering on Camel for many, many years, more than 8 years. Wrote a book together with a colleague, Jonathan, and currently we are writing the second edition of that book. We will have the last chapters ready by the end of the year, so the book should be out in early next year. Okay, let's move on. So, how many here knows about Apache Camel? Okay, that's for the video, that's maybe half the people. That's good because there are some content for new people here and also something for you guys that already know Camel. So, to learn about what a software product is, a good idea is to go to the product website and see what they say. On the Camel website, we say that Camel is an integration framework and it's based on enterprise integration patterns. Okay, so as an integration framework, I like to picture Camel as a toolbox which has ready-made tools for you guys to use to help with your integration needs. So you as a developer should not need to write code how to connect to message brokers or other systems to send messages, to receive messages and all that kind of things. All that is taken care of the lower end by Camel and allows you to focus at a higher level on your business problems. Okay, but the other fact, what is enterprise integration patterns? Well, it's in fact a book with that same title. It's a big American book, so it's 800,000 pages. It's published over 10 years ago, but we know it as the Integration Bible. It's a very good book, and the authors of the book, Gregor Hobey and Bobby Wolf, were consultants that went out to clients back then and helped them with their integration needs. And what they did was see the same problems occurring over and over again. So what they did was to write down these problems, but also how they actually found out a solution for them. And after a while, they figured out that there are so many notes they're taking that this could be turned into a book. And that's where we have today, a book. In this book, we have enterprise patterns as a solution for enterprise problems. And we have 65 patterns in the book. And here are some on the slides. So we have a famous pattern called content-based router, which we're going to see in a moment. You can filter messages. You can route messages dynamic, you can send messages to a number of recipients, you can split messages and aggregate and so on and so on. Okay, that is a book, but what about Apache Camel? Where does Apache Camel fit into this? I would like to spend a little time talking about this. Now, think that you work in the IT industry, yay, and you have a business problem, you have an order system, and you have some new orders coming in, and depending on what kind of order it is, it has to be either sent to a widget system or gadget system. So how can you find a solution for that? Yes, we keep this example very simple, but just to explain the principle. So if you take the book, you can find a pattern for that, which is called the content-based router here on the slide, and you have a graphical notation of it. But what we would like to do as well is to have a write down using English words the solution for that. So pay attention what happens now. So you can say, from new order, then I need to make a choice. And when is widget, to widget, otherwise to gadget. Sorry guys, if you can't see in the back, I can probably not move the slides up. Then you add parentheses. Then you add some dots. And in the end, you add a semicolon, okay? Now we've written down that using English words. And now we have something in the blue. What is that? So let's try to be more specify that. So in this example, we are picking up orders from a message broker using Apache ActiveMQ on a queue called new order. So you can specify that as an endpoint here. Okay. Then we need to figure out if that order is a widget or not. And for that, we can use a predicate. And this example is rather old, so it uses XML content. So we can use an XML language called XPart as the predicate to determine if that order is the widget or not. Likewise, we want to send that order to a widget system or gadget system, and we can send it to the same message broker on different queues like widget and gadget. Okay, maybe you can see where we're going, where Apache Camel starts to come into the picture. As a developer, as a Java developer, this looks like something that is familiar to you guys. Yes, it is Java code. And Java code should be in a method. So let's take the Java code and put it inside a method, and we can call this method configure. Okay. A Java method should be in a class, so we put that inside a class and call that class myRoute. Now that route extends route builder. And route builder is our first clue about Camel, because that is a class from Camel that allows you to define Camel routes in the configure method. So all this code here you can actually compile and run with Camel. The only thing you actually need to do additional is to configure that ActiveMQ component to tell it about the message broker, which one to use, you know, the URL for that. But that's it. Also, if you can see the button, then the route here in this is a DSL and Camel. It's sort of like a very high-level abstraction of the business problem, where there's no low-level code here. There's no low-level code how to connect to the message broker, how to execute the XPath predicate, and so on and so on. All that is abstracted away, and it allows you to work on a higher level about the business problem expressed in these routing DSL. Now, in Camel, it's probably a bit more common to inline those endpoints and predicates and so on directly into the route. So this is the same code here. And as you can see, if you take this code and show to someone who's not a developer, maybe your boss or someone else, that person, he or she, will likely have some sort of understanding what is going on, because it's more related to English words, right? Camel also allows you to define routes, not in Java code, but in XML. So here we can define a similar solution just in XML, where we have a route and from and choice and when and otherwise and so on and so on. The Java DSL and the XML DSL are aligned one-to-one, so you can always do in both of them. There's no trade-off. And from Camel point of view, when you run this one, it doesn't matter. Camel don't care. At runtime, they are both the same inside Camel. Another really great feature with Camel is that it's easy to use different components. So for example, if you need to pick up the orders from the file system instead of the broker, all you have to do is change up here to specify, I want to use the file component and then the directory where those files are located. All these Camel components can be endpoints can be configured. They have each component has different options. So for example, after you have picked up the file and processed that by the Camel route, and then at the end, you can decide, okay, I want to delete that file. So, or you can choose to move it somewhere else or leave it or something like that. There's many different options on the file component to customize what you want to do. Now, if I told you guys, if you need to pick up the files from an FTP server instead of the file component, it wouldn't be too hard for you guys to figure out what to do, because Camel has an FTP component. And then you just need to tell the component, okay, what is the name of the FTP server, the port number, maybe the username and the password to log in. And more or less, you're done. Okay. Camel is just Java code. There's no magic intermediate language or anything like that. So you can use all the powers of your Java editors at your disposal, IDEA, Eclipse, and whatnot. Control space, you get the method selection of what you want to use. Also in XML, there are the Camel XML in has a schema behind it, XSD. So the editors should be able to pick that up and then give you code assistance there as well. And the schema is also documented, so you can actually, you know, look up and see what their parameters are and the patterns and whatnot. So what is the high-level architect of Camel? So this is the 10,000 foot, 3,000 kilometers, 3 kilometers architect of Camel. So in the center, you have Camel context. That is Camel. It's the runtime Camel. Then the idea is that you can add routes to the Camel. In these routes, you can use these enterprise patterns and business processes and do message enrichment, transformation, and so on. And then you use components to integrate or speak to the outside world. So we already saw the ActiveM component, there's a GMS component, there's file component, FTP component, HTTP, and so on and so on. In fact, there's so many components in Camel that we have a number of slides with tables with just the component names, and they just keep going on. And it's actually hard to actually have a specific count how many components there are. There's going to be a slide later where we can see actually how many there are. So what is Camel, if you want to see that in a picture? So I like to think Camel is that integration toolbox, okay? You have this awesome toolbox with ready-made tools for you to work at a higher level. Then you have this awesome book, the Enterprise Patterns book, that has all these recipes how to solve integration problems. Then you define these Camel routes using these patterns. And then you use these components to communicate or speak to the outside world. And then you have a Camel. So I could just show you this slide instead of all the other slides, right? Okay, so this is code from the first release of Camel, Camel 1.0. You can see the route is here with the configure method. It's from ActiveMQ to a file, and then from a file, and then does inline processor where you do some system out. Okay, this is from the first release. This is the same code today if you have to write it using the latest release. And pay attention. I just did a duplicate of the code, but the code compiles and works the same. There's no code changes needed. So that you can say that James Strachan, who created Camel, nailed it from the very first beginning. You know, the DSL and was right from the very beginning. So sort of now that's a question. You can win these playing cards here, awesome playing cards. How long time is there between the first release and the current release you saw here? And we are talking about not months, I can give you that, but years. Is it 1 year, 5 years?
10 years.
10 years. Almost, 9 years. Camel is 9 years old. It was released in summer 2007, and next year in the summer we will have a 10-year anniversary. And then, because it's IT system, I'm not sure what happens if it's gonna make it for 11. But we're gonna have a big party then. Okay. Only two left. So let's try a little example. This is the hello world of integration. There's no fancy UI. There's no sexy going on with mobile phones and whatnot. It's just borrowing, copy a file from one directory to another. But you know, this is what we do sometimes. So how can you build that with Camel? Camel is easy to get started with. You can just use a plain static void main class. And then you need to create a Camel context. And there's a good old new constructor in Java. Just use that, new default context. Then you can add routes to it. And to keep the code on one slide, I use an inline route builder. We have the configure method. Here you can define the routing DSL, and you just say from file inbox to file outbox. And then you need to start Camel and keep it running. But pay attention to the start method in Camel is non-blocking. So this is a mistake some people do if they don't have the sleep and the stop. It just boot up and go down. So how can you avoid this if you just want to run it? Well, we provide a main class from Camel, and you just call the run method. But otherwise, the other things are the same. So that is a way of running Camel totally standalone. But there are many ways to run Camel. So how can you get trying Camel by yourself? And this is maybe an old way of doing it. You can go to the Camel website. There's a box, you know, because Camel is so old, so it was back then when we actually distributed software in a box. And there's a button to download it. You can unzip the Camel, and there's some examples you can try and run. And the very beginner example is something called Camel Example Console. It reads from your standard in prompt, and then it streams it out, and in between it does something. I guess everybody can kind of figure out what it does. So you can try and play with that and maybe be very creative and try to lowercase or something. But that's a bit boring example, so let's try to have a bit more fun. We have the internet here. So there's a Twitter example. Yeah, that's a famous one. So I boot that up with from Maven. You couldn't probably see it, but there's a Maven plugin called Camel Run, so you can run something. And this example will then if it does, let's see, some tweets are coming here, and this is, I'm sorry, I'm not very good at making nice web pages, but this is what people tweet about Lady Gaga. If I choose camel, it will have to wait a longer time, and it will probably be more about smoking camel, or I'm not sure there's any female in the audience, but sometimes there are some people spotting for camel. So Lady Gaga is always a famous lady. And okay, how much code is there for that? That's, you know, in camel it's just three lines of code, more or less, from Twitter, then log, and then to a WebSocket, and then there's some WebSocket. But that's not the... then you need to, for Twitter, of course, you need to set some credentials to be able to actually access Twitter. But they show you how to do that. And what was I want to show? Then there's one other cool thing going on. I can start a hot IO, which is a web console that you can use to look inside Java applications, that can look inside any JVM. So I actually run the Twitter example, is still running, and now I run the hot IO in another Java JVM. And it's able to look inside my local laptop and see what Java processes are running, and it discovered that Apache Camel is running. And I can click this button here, and I can create a connector to it, and I can click that one, and now I look inside the other JVM where Camel is running. And now it has detected that there is Camel running inside that Java JVM, and it shows you a Camel button up here, and it lists all the Camel contexts you're running. And this example, we only have one Camel route, and I can click the route diagram, and I can get a somewhat nice diagram. I just have to refresh it, and it looks better. There's a bug in that. So now we can see from Twitter, there's 61 messages received, and we logged it, and we saw it to the WebSocket. And this web console has many different features for Camel and other things you can use to see it. But what I wanted to demonstrate as well is also one thing that maybe stand out Camel a bit, is that all these Camel components and so on, they include documentation out of the box in the binaries. So at runtime, you can use this tool to actually look at how your endpoints has been configured and what all these options mean. So here we look at the Twitter component, a Twitter endpoint, and you can see all these options are grouped together, and you can see all these options down here. So from the consumer, you can see here, there's an option called Bridge Overhand, and you have all this documentation, and so on and so on. And I think that's a good thing, because this documentation is also available for you in tooling. So while you build Camel application, but the same documentation is available at runtime. So you can maybe have, so when you come back to it, and you, how is this option configured like that? And you can actually see it at runtime. Okay, let's leave that and go back to the slides. And just kill these two applications and go back to the slides. And another popular way of getting started with Camel you can try is to use these websites. Now there's a Spring Boot starter website, and you have Camel as a part of the dependencies. A good choice is the web and the actuator, and then Camel. In my second talk, we're going to see this. We're going to build a Camel application using Spring Boot. If you're using Wildfire Swarm, they also have a starter page. It's called a generator, but the same idea. You can choose all your dependencies, but Wildfire Swarm is more about Java EE. But Camel works awesome in there as well, so you can run Camel in either one. Okay, so what features does Camel also have besides what we talked about now? So what is there in this Camel box? That's quite a lot, but first and foremost, there's all these enterprise patterns from this book, right? So you can also think about Camel is the software implementation of that book. Then there are a few key patterns. One is called the pipes and filters. This is named like that because the idea is like on the Unix shell, where all you have a command that does one thing well and only one thing, and then you can pipe it to the next command. So the idea is that the output of one command becomes input to the next, and then you can chain them together. This is the pipes and filters. And the pattern naming Camel is called pipeline. But pipeline is the default mode in Camel. So what you see often is people just do it like this. So it's from 2 to 2. So, you know, in between these two, then the output of decrypt becomes input to authenticate. Another pattern which is actually quite good is a recipient list. A recipient list allows you to send a message to one or more recipients, but compute dynamically based on the content on the message, something like that. So for example, if you have a REST service where we want to send a stock quote to a message queue where the stock quote symbol is part of that queue name, this is how you can do it. You can see here how we expose a REST service where the symbol is dynamic, which maps to the queue name over here as a camel header. Now, this is a way of doing it in the, let's say, older releases of Camel, but in recent version of Camel, we introduced a 2D, two dynamic. So you just write it like this. It's a bit shorter to do. And speaking of REST, REST is quite famous, and Camel introduces a REST DSL. So you can define REST service in Camel, sort of like using REST verbs. So we can define here, we have a REST service from stocks, and where you can do a post to it with the symbol, and then it can send it to that queue. And then you can configure the REST DSL outside of the DSL. So here we say we want to use the Camel RESTlet component on port 9080. The REST DSL support many different Camel components as a choice for which actual HTTP transport you want to use. This one is using RESTless, but you can also use Jersey, Servlet, Netty, and a few others. Also very famous pattern is the splitter. So you have a file, you want to split it line by line. Each line, you need to transform that from some sort of in-house format to some maybe XML and send it to a message queue. Four patterns. And this is how in Camel, from file inbox, you want to split the message body using a tokenizer, a new line tokenizer. And then we want to marshal that or convert that line to some XML. And because that line is not a common format, we have to build a custom data format. But if the file, for example, was using a very common format like CSV or JSON or something, then there are out-of-the-box components in Camel that can transform from that. And then to the line. So you can see four patterns up here, four lines of Java code in Camel. Quite nice when they match one-to-one, if they do. And speaking of components, so we have a Camel catalog in Camel that actually include all kind of information about Camel. And you can ask that one, how many components are there? And do a word count. So there's 218. And now that number is somehow a bit big. It depends on how you count a component, because we have Amazon Web Service component. In that, do have like 10 different components, depending on what kind of Amazon service you're using, the queuing service, the SMS, and whatnot. But there's one artifact, Camel ABS. And then there's 10 sub-components in that. And that's why it's 218, but a lot. I talked a bit about data format before. A data format allows you to transform a message from a well-known form to another one. So typical is XML to Java, and Java to XML, but also JSON and CSV and so on. It's like a two-way operation, so you have marshal and unmarshal. But you can also use it for compression and decompression, and encryption and decompression. And there's 47 of those. Here is an example with JaxB. JaxB comes from Java out of the box, so we have a POTO class which we can annotate with JaxB. And then we can tell Camel, okay, I pick up an XML file. I want to take that XML file and marshal into the POTO class using JaxB. Then I call a bean where I use the POTO to do something. And then I want to take back that POTO and convert it back to XML using the unmarshal, and then save it to a file. Now, when you use data format, there's only like, it's like a USB stick. It can sometimes turn the wrong side. So I also sometimes confuses whether it's a marshal or unmarshal I need to use. Is that going to either one? So that just a warning. Oh, some water. Camel also allows you to use scripting language. For example, there is a Spring Expression language, there are Groovy, there's Python, and And ML and OGNL, those are for calling Java code and so on. But there's one language in Camel that comes out of the box. It's called Symbol. And the reason for that is because it was, yes, very simple when it was created. You know, Camel is 9 years old, so that language couldn't do so much. Then over the time, we have improved it to do more and more things. But the name is stuck with Symbol. Maybe it should have been called Camel Expression Language today, but it's not. It's called Symbol. So here we can use Symbol to transform the message saying something like, hi, I am, and then the host name of the system where you're on it, hello, some sort of name, how are you today? So you can use it for something like that as well. Now you can also use Groovy. Groovy is quite powerful. So for example, if you have a message body, a message that has a producer, a list of orders, and you probably can't see it, but there are three lines of orders here, and they all have a price, 50, 40, and 60. What we want to do is to see if that total is more than 100, and you can use Groovy to that. So you just want to call the amount, get amount on the POJO, and do a sum of all those. And this is standard Groovy language. Camel provides the DSL where you define the routes. We've seen the Java DSL and the XML DSL. And when you use XML, you have to use either Spring or something called OSGI Blueprint. Those are for the OSGI users. And then there's also a Groovy and a Scala DSL. But people are not using these latter two so much. These ones are the best ones. And one of the reasons is that there comes Camel. The Java DSL is from the Camel core, and the XML DSL is generated based on the core, so they're always in sync. Whereas if you these two, you have to manually add some extra features and whatnot. But they are there. One thing that people may mistake think about Camel is that it's sort of like a server technology, so you always have to run Camel on a server. It doesn't have to be. It's actually just a library. It's just a bunch of jar files. So any Java JVM you have, you can just add the Camel jars and run it. So for example, if you need to send, let's say your boss says you have a Java application, you know, and you need to upload some data to an FTP server as a file, and how can you do that? So one thing is that you will have to maybe go to the internet and find out which FTP libraries are there for Java and study them and figure out how to use them. But you can also just use Camel. And Camel provides something called a producer template. And this is similar to the Spring templates, like the REST templates and the JDBC templates and so on. So it's more or less only one line of code to do something. So what you need to do is get a hold of Camel context. Then you can create a producer template from it. Then here we have some sort of the data we want to send as FTP, some byte array, the name of the file. And then we define the FTP endpoint here. And then we can use the producer template to send that body. And we need to provide a header as well to specify what is the name of the file we uploaded to the FTP server. So essentially, this is one line of code that does all that, you know, to connect to the FTP server, send it, and so on and so on. Now, in recent time, we're introducing a API. So we can just say, this is where you want to send it to with this bus body, with this header, and then send. Camel comes with test kits out of the box. This was really awesome, also in the first release when I got started with Camel, is that you can start using Camel, but you know, how do I write unit tests, or how do you try it out, and something like that. So a unit test with the test kits is very good. We have a different kind of environments. Camel test is just for Java, for Spring and CDI, and OSGI Blueprint, and so on. We used to have a test ng for the alternative testing library instead of JUnit, but we don't see many people using it, and we are tired of maintaining that one, so we are deprecating that. So just use JUnit like everybody else. So here's an example from a unit test inside Camel itself. So the Camel test allows you to extend the Camel test support class. That was sort of like the old, good old way of doing it, but in the recent time, you can also use without having to test extend the class, and then use annotations, you know, the JUnit runner classes and so on. but this is a good old way of doing it. So here you can have the route builder where you define what route, camel route you want to test, and then you have a test method. So what you want to do is that from this code, you can actually just run and debug inside your Java editor. So this is also a good way of working a bit with camel, is how can I actually run camel but in debug mode. You can just write a unit test with a little test method. So this one is testing using a mock, and a camel mock allows you to set up some expectations. So here we expect that we will receive a message within content hello world. Then we send message into camel, you know, somehow trigger some activity going on in camel. Then at the end, we assert that these mocks are satisfied, you know, they actually received all these kind of things. And then it will either succeed or fail. Camel also allows you to manage camel at runtime using DMX. So when you run camel in application servers or standalone or whatnot, you can use DMX to, you know, look inside camel, which was in fact what, if you can remember back, there was this web console with hot.io, the graphical one. It's actually using DMX as well to integrate with camel, where it can, you know, introspect the camel routes and start and stop them. Camel using DMX provides a lot of information. There's a lot of runtime statistics about camel, how many messages have been processed, how many has failed, and so on. What are the errors, processing time, and the minimum and the maximum, and so on. And you get that at different levels. You can get at the highest level at the camel context, where it's sort of aggregating for all the things. But you can also get it for each route you have. And even down, you know, on each route, you can go down to each of the enterprise patterns. So you have a like high level and low level, where you can sort of figure out and find out where are my bottlenecks. You know, which of these patterns are the one that takes the longest time to process these methods, for example. Another feature of a camel is actually something that is maybe a bit harder to implement correctly. It takes some time, and people are maybe not appreciate that. But how do you to start up, let's say, camel with the routes or like an application server or something like that? Things start up, and then it runs for a while, and that's fine. But how do you stop it nicely, gracefully, you know, so you don't get a ton of errors and all the messages that are currently being processed, they are allowed to continue process without any failures, and you wait for these to complete, and then you start it down, and you have to do it in the right order and close all the resources and so on and so on. That's actually not so trivial to implement. So, but camel comes out of the box with a graceful shutdown functionality. And during the shutdown, it also stops taking in new messages, but has to keep on some routes going on because they are maybe using for internal routing. So these routes must be running because the other routes are depending on those. But those routes that take outside messages coming, please try to stop those so they don't take in new messages while I still complete these messages I still have, and so on. If you run camel in some containers like Carafe, SourceMix, or JBoss Fuse, we have camel commands you can install, and you can also, like JMX, manage your camel application. You can list them all, you can start and stop routes and get information out of that. So they have sort of like a little shell, these application servers. And the same command also works with Spring Boot. I'm not so sure if people are aware of that, but Spring Boot also allows you to SSH into a Spring Boot instance and has a little command. And we have that for camel also. I talked about the REST DSL briefly in the pattern. So this one is quite elaborate. But the REST DSL in camel allows you also to describe the REST service using human descriptions and also specify all the parameters of the query parameters and the form data and all kind of things. And this is what we've done here. Then we can configure the REST DSL, where we can configure, for example, I want to have a print output, so the client sees a nicely formatted JSON or XML. What are the context path or port number, but you can also turn on spec API. So this is what I've done down here, and turn on course. And this allows camel to actually generate a spec API based on that REST DSL, which, you know, so you can have APIs for your clients to consume. And you can, for example, using the Swagger UI, and point it to the API, and you can use the UI to call the REST service in a nice form. And well, you can run it, try it out, but in interest of time, let's move on. Okay, so if doing integration was just easy, that everything just works, and you know, distributed system always works and whatnot, I think Jeb had talked about this in the previous talk, that they are inherent to always fail at some point of time. So we need to deal with errors. You know, we can just not just drink coffee and don't care. No, we actually have to deal with these errors. So in traditional things in Java code, a way of dealing with errors is that an exception is being thrown from somewhere, and you can try to handle that error by doing try catch style. In the Camel route, we have a similar thing. You can use a do try and do catch. So if something goes on in this code block, maybe sending the message to this WebSVM queue, then the exception is cat here, and we can send it somewhere else. So it's a similar thing of doing it, but this is not always the best case of doing it, because you know, you can also externalize your error handling to more generic way. In Camel, you can use the error handler. And in this error handler, we're using a strategy called dead letter channel. Dead letter channel is from the EIP book. It's a pattern in that book that is specific about how to deal with errors that are poisonous, that you know, you cannot really process. How can you solve that? And one solution is to take that message and move it somewhere else, you know, to a dead letter queue, usually for some sort of manual introspection or some other system to take on and try to figure out what the hell is this. Then the other system can, you know, continue on, and maybe you can continue on picking up the next message and process that and whatnot. You can also specify redelivery. So for example, if we are trying to send a message to this queue and there's some networking issue, you know, it may be okay for us to try to redeliver that message, and we can specify that here. I want to try up till 5 times and have 5 seconds delay in between. Now, the error handler has a lot of options for you to customize with all kind of things you can turn on and off. A bit crazy how many they are. Then in the Microsoft world, there is a pattern that is quite famous called the circuit breaker. And in the next release of Camel, we introduce the Netflix Hystrix as an enterprise pattern in Camel. So we can use Hystrix here as the pattern. Then what comes in here is executed as a Netflix Hystrix command. And then if that command fails, then you can do an all fallback. And in the fallback here, we just does a message transformation saying, nobody want to talk to me. So usually you can use the circuit breaker to sort of throttle downstream service. So if you're calling a downstream service and you don't want to overheat that one, or that downstream service is too busy and whatnot, Hystrix can shield you from problems trying to still. It doesn't really help to try to keep calling that service if it's just too busy. It cannot process. So the circuit breaker can sort of open, and then it can intercept that call and don't even try to call that downstream service. It just do the fallback instead. And then after a while, it allows one of those to call the service downstream. If that is okay, then it assumes the service is back up and running, and then it can allow the others to continue. Netflix has built a dashboard for this where you can see all these circuit breakers, what the state are and whatnot. And you can, you know, if you Camel supports that as well, where you can read from those. And you can see here the circuit breaker there has been 10 errors, so there are some errors, and you can see that. There's an example in the next release of Camel where you can try it out on locally. But again, on interest of time, we have to move on. One thing that people also use to get started or use Camel is that you can use Maven archetypes for creating new Camel projects. It depends on what kind of things you're doing. And again, if you're using Spring Boot or maybe Wildfire Swarm, then that web page is maybe better. But the old-fashioned Maven archetypes are pretty cool as well to create all kind of different products. If you need to create a new Camel component, we have an archetype for that. And there's also a new archetype for Java 8 because we are introducing a new experimental or Java DSL that has Java 8 features with Lambda style. And we are doing that, you know, in a gradual way. We don't go full bonanza in the first release. So we're just doing a little bit and showing it to the community, and then the community come with their feedbacks, and then we iterate on that, and then the next release gets better and better. That also means that the API in the Java 8 DSL is subject to change. You know, it's not fixed yet. A good plugin is the Camel Maven plugin, so you can use that to run Camel and whatnot, which I used. Another one that is actually quite interesting is from, actually not from Apache Camel, but from the Fabricate product, but we will probably move that to Apache Camel at a time later. It allows you to validate all your Camel endpoints and whatnot in your source code and report any errors, because Camel actually otherwise will fail at startup because if you misconfigure something. So this tool can actually introspect all your source code and find these validation errors and report it. And I just have a way here. So let's say this is a Boolean option. So if I mistake that, I type something else, and I can run this plugin here, validate. Control F5, and it runs down here. Move it up a bit. And here you can see there's an error in this one, send to all invalid Boolean value 444. 444 is not a Boolean, of course. So I can go back to true, but I can also make a mistake here, like a lowercase a in send to all. I'll run it again. And it should report that. Send to all, unknown option, did you mean? And then it can come with suggestions, you know, if you make spelling mistakes. The idea is that if you can get this tooling inside the IDEs, and you can sort of make these while you type, that is the longer term goal. But you can use that in your Maven project. Set it up as a Palm plugin, and it can, you know, make it run as you compile your code, and it can maybe do the warnings for you, or you make it even, you know, fail your compile. But a nice little tool. All the other stuff, which is maybe for extended Camel talk, what Camel comes out of the box, which are you can use transaction, interceptor, security, threat management, reactive is coming, asynchronous non-blocking routing engine. You can use Proteus for with enterprise patterns, and there are features to how you can actually debug your Camel routes, sort of like not on a Java code level, but on a higher level on the enterprise pattern. So you can sort of step by step through all these patterns. So again, running Camel. Camel is just a bunch of Java files. You can run it in any JVM you want to run it. It also works with big vendors like WebSphere or Oracle and all these kind of things. Basically anywhere you have Java. But these are some of the most famous ones. And there's a special Camel component in the Vertex product, Vertex Camel, that comes from the Vertex product. And I have some links for more information about Camel. I do fairly much blog about Camel. We do have a lot of links for what else other people are talking about Camel on a link collection called Articles. We do have some Camel videos on Vimeo, but also on YouTube. You can find quite a lot of them. And if this is the best article I can find about what is Camel, if you know, have a colleague or something that wants to know what Camel is, and you have a cup of coffee and you have 5-10 minutes, then you go to that web link and see what it is. It has a nice use case where it talks about Camel. It's in fact written by Jonathan, who is the co-author of the Camel Action book. Okay, so we have time for questions, and there are playing cards. I'll also be around so you guys can catch me. That's a very good question. You'll get one. So Camel is just the library. Can you pass it on to him? So Service Mix is an application server, but based on OSGI. So in Service Mix, you can deploy applications. They can be in Sky. They can include Camel. They can include other things like just a plain WAR file or something like that. But the idea with the Service Mix product was that it is like an umbrella project where it takes on other Apache products and build an ESB. So it will take Camel as the routing library. It will take Apache XMQ as the message broker. It will take Apache CXF as the SOAP and REST library, and a few other things. Carafe is the underlying container. And all that kind of things comes together, and then they sort of have like a, you know, easy way of installing things, and they know they work together because these versions work together. So that's the idea. So if you want to look for OSGI and run an application server, then service mix, you know, is the way to go. If you are just caution, OSGI is different than, if you haven't used it before, you can, you know, trip you. So, you know, just be aware, but it's also good when you actually get it and it works. So it has its ups and downs, let me just say that. And, you know, it works well in those where we have one big giant JVM and run a lot of application servers, but maybe where we're going now is the opposite direction. And then where maybe service mix is not the answer. Fleming? Okay, so he is actually a camera user that found the secret thing, right? I could throw it, but I might hit your head. So what is the difference between the circuit breaker that was already inside Camel that you may not know, and then the Netflix version, which I showed on the slides? So the difference is that the circuit breaker that was in Camel as a load balancer is our crappy implementation of the pattern, whereas the Hystrix one is the real thing. So you actually add the Hystrix Java libraries. So you get all the thread pool and all the thing, and Netflix is maintaining that, and you know, you get that their version. I'm not saying that our version is super crappy, but it doesn't have all the features and it's not so used. But you could use it, and if it fits your need, then perfect. But you can't use all these Netflix options they have. Okay, is there end of time?
Oh,
thank you. It's not dead yet.